Hare Krishna, we will do Bhagavad Gita, chapter 3, verse 41. Tasmatvam indriyanyadau niyamya bharatarshabha papmanam prajahi hyenam jnana vijnana nashanam. Translation, chapter 3, verse 41. Therefore, O Arjuna, best of the Bharatas, in the very beginning, curb this great symbol of sin, means lust, by regulating the senses, and slay this destroyer of knowledge and self-realization. See, Krishna is calling this sin, means this lust, you know, as the destroyer of knowledge and the destroyer of self-realization. So because of lust, you know, we become blind. We become so focused. It's like, you know, if I want this item now, I want now only. Then we cannot think of anything else. No, now. Small children are like that. No, I want now. I want now. I want. They cannot think of anything, you know, that if I buy now, maybe another baby is going to come home tomorrow. That child is going to break it in one shot. You know, if I buy it 3 days later, it's going to remain safe. These things and all will not come. No, I want it. And when the baby comes and breaks, then they realize, oh, no, you buy one more. No, let this baby go, then you buy. Then we could have thought of it beforehand only, na? That's what, when lust comes and conquers our mind, then nothing actually works. We simply, you know, become blind and follow the dictations of our lusty desires. Now, what to do with this lust? That's why Krishna says, in the very beginning, curb this great symbol of sin. In the very beginning, when I got a daughter, you know, in 2001, June, I was thinking, now this girl's responsibility is mine. I have to make sure she's going to be a girl of pure character, sincerity, competence, and devotion. So now I knew it, that because of Bhagavad Gita, that if there is devotion in the child, then everything will follow. It's like the eldest Didi, you know. When Didi called devotion is there, when the eldest sister of devotion is there, then all the saintly qualities, all the 26 qualities of Vaishnava will come, you know, automatically they come. But when you have the Didi called lust, then all anger, you know, all destruction, everything, other sister qualities of lust will come. So that is why, you know, first only I was thinking, before she enters into teenage, she should be very clear about what is right and what is wrong based on Bhagavad Gita. And she should be very clear of what are the different levels of happinesses. You know, there is happiness even for tamasic people. Their happiness is in looting people, in, you know, gambling and winning and killing, murdering. Yeah, that is, yeah, I did that. I finished my enemy. Very simple, and they consider that as joy, you know, because they don't know some higher joy. What is the happiness of a Rajasic person? To make fun of others and laugh. Because Rajasic person, Raja, you know, he thinks he's great. You know, he's the king. Like, he thinks he's a hero actually. He may be a zero, but he thinks he's a hero. Therefore, he thinks that if I make others into zero, then only I'll appear like a hero, you know. In other words, they just get happiness by mocking at others, you know. That is, they don't go and kill people, but they just mock people. Means they're killing the fame of the others, you know, by making fun, you know. So then they get happiness. This is Rajasic happiness. Satvic people, they don't enjoy this kind of jokes of making fun of others and all that. They may even make fun of themselves, and they will laugh and they make others laugh. You know, I ask my husband to give me a drop, even if I have to go to 5 kilometers distance, and if there's a bus at, you know, 1 kilometer distance, I don't like to walk if he is agreeing to give a drop. So I ask, will you just drop halfway? Then I'll walk halfway. He's happy to drop. Since I always ask him, I had to go to second floor to meet his friend's daughter. So he was asking, shall I come to drop you in by car to second floor of the building? You know, so this is a very light joke, you know. So light jokes, you know, where you are not making fun of the other, okay, but there is some affection involved, or you are making fun of your own self, okay. So these things are very sattvic jokes. So, and Krishna used to create jokes, you know, and all of them used to laugh. When actually Krishna, was wanting to eat butter, the gopis used to say, come on, dance like a peacock. And Krishna used to dance like a peacock, you know, for a little bit of butter. And gopis used to laugh. See how Krishna is dancing like that. And, you know, sometimes his gopa friends, they used to say, hey, Krishna, I'm going to give you something very nice. You know, but you should close your eyes and open your mouth. I'm going to put something very nice in your mouth. And then when Krishna opens his mouth with closed eyes, they put something into Krishna's mouth and he closes to taste it. Okay, and it's so much, they would put some sour tasting flower into the mouth of Krishna, that he would make, you know, all kinds of expressions, and the gopa boys used to laugh, and Krishna used to do that so that they will laugh, you know. So when we talk about Krishna and when we try to laugh hearing about his intelligence, his wittiness, you know, his humor, so that is Shuddha Sattva, you know. Hearing about God and, you know, laughing, that's Shuddha Sattva. So here, you know, we have to understand that there are different types of people. So there are different levels of lust. But for whatever level, you know, so, you know, if you want the lust to be completely curbed, so we have to focus about treating children in a way that they get attracted to life of Krishna consciousness. That's what I did with my daughter. I didn't want her to be disturbed by lust in her teenage. So from childhood, you know, I gave her some activities that she saw some bliss, you know. Whatever made her happy, I would just make her engage in that. And whatever would make her sad, I removed her sadness by using the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita. If she comes to me with any kind of complaint, I would say, see, Bhagavad Gita is saying like this. So if you just understand this way, then you will not be sad. For example, if she is coming to me and saying that, oh, I got less mark. You know, again, I could not get 100 out of 100. Instead of 90 out of 90, I just got 60 out of 90 in maths in this midterm exam. I would say it's okay, you know. So you will get trained to not get attached to result. You know, you are attached to result, na? That's why you are getting this kind of result. The many more times if you get like this, then you'll forget about result and you'll only focus on learning. So you were learning nicely. I was very happy, isn't it, the way you were learning. You were also happy that you were learning. So now practice was not enough. Next time, you know what you have to do. So like this, you know, means taking away her focus from the result and making her focus on learning, practicing. You know, and I told her, you see, you are enjoying that you are learning, you are enjoying that you are practicing, you are enjoying that you are understanding. So, you know, using Bhagavad Gita, I was telling, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, second chapter, Karmanyevadhikaraste Mapaleshu Kadachana, you have no right to demand a result. So forget about the result, just learn. So she's telling, yeah, I will now onwards just learn. So she's getting some peace only from Bhagavad Gita. If I say, oh, it's okay, you leave it. How I cannot leave it, you know. I wanted that result, I worked for it, I didn't get it. So now when we say the results will come only based on your Punya Karma, I told. If you were having so much Punya Karma in stock, it would come. But sometimes if Krishna loves you, he keeps all your Punya Karma together. He doesn't give you now. And at the end, when you really need it, he starts giving everything. So don't worry. Then she becomes happy. Ah, that is nice. You know, there's a story. Just a joke. One boy, young boy, you know, he was very much controlled by his parents. And those parents, you know, wouldn't leave him to go out, party, go out with girls. He was not even given a mobile phone and things like that. He completed his engineering like that under the supervision of his parents, especially the father. And then he was going, you know, then he got a nice job also because of his good marks and austere life. And when he's going abroad, you know, his father asked him after he reached, So what is the salary you're going to get? He said $4,000, and he was planning in the aeroplane that, you know, now I'll go there, now I'll do a little bit of boozing and going after girls, I'll enjoy, my parents are not there to supervise. He was quite making all those plans. And when he said $4,000, father said, okay, then beta, 3,000 India bhej dena. He said, 3,000, you send it to my account, and 1,000 you manage because we need money. The son couldn't say no. He was so scared of his father. He said, okay. But then when he saw that $1,000 was just enough for him to go to office, come back, eat his food. And he was not left with anything to go for partying, to go after girls. So he was so sad and frustrated. So after 3-4 years, the father told, now I'll get you married. Now there's a good girl, you get married. Then he said, okay. And then he married. And on the day of his marriage, you know, when his wife is there, the father comes to the son and says, beta, take this much amount of money for you. He said, this much? How did you get this much savings? All the money you were sending, na, $3,000 per month, I kept it safely to give it to you only. You know why I didn't give you? Because if I would give you that time, you would drink, you would go after girls and make merry, and you'll spoil your life, you'll spoil your health, you'll spoil your habits. That is why I took it away from you. Now your wife has come, na. She's the policeman. She will make sure in your mobile, if you call to any other lady, she will know. She'll keep an eye on you. So she will now take care of the finance matters, and she'll run the house so you can enjoy with your savings. You know, if you want to go abroad, you want to come back with your wife, you want to buy a house, whatever you want, now you use it. So here the father is like Krishna. Sincere son is like a sincere devotee. You know, taking the money is like, you know, sometimes Krishna for his devotees may withhold their karma, good karmas, you know. He may not give, because he will give them when they are mature, when they are ready to receive it without becoming egoistic, without falling down. So when the right time comes, Krishna will himself give us. So that is why, no need to worry. When I told my daughter, she was very satisfied. So like this, I used to take away my daughter's pain using Bhagavad Gita or using some devotees' classes. His Grace Radhesham Prabhu was telling this story in a class, actually, for the youthful boys. So, you know, the same story I was telling to my daughter, who is also in her teenage. And that was very convincing. So like this Bhagavad Gita, I used to remove all her pain from her life. So she got so attached to hearing lectures, because now she knows by hearing she herself can get solutions to her problems. So she's loving to hear because she can get rid of her problems. She wants to be happy. She knows Bhagavad Gita is the only way. So like this, she knows by chanting, her focus is improving. With her focus improvement, she's able to focus on studies better. So she knows that by not watching TV, and by not watching, hearing any unwanted songs, she can stay mentally peaceful. Otherwise, you know, Prabhupada says in the purport, if a person has, you know, transformed. Now, what is this lust? It is the love for Krishna, you know, perverted version. You know, when the love of Krishna spoils, it is lust. So, from the beginning, if we don't allow the lust to take place in the heart of a new child, you know, give them only the happy experiences of Krishna consciousness. If we give them only the happy experience of Krishna consciousness, they'll experience love of Krishna right from the childhood. So then what happens? Then they will not fall down to lust. But what if they have fallen down to lust and we want to help them? There it is very difficult, says Prabhupada in the purport. But then also, Krishna consciousness is so powerful that anyone with any degree of lust, he can come out of it with sufficient sincere practice in Krishna consciousness. But if we don't do that, and if we allow the lust to overtake, you know, our intelligence, then we are going to do many sinful activities, and therefore lots of destruction will happen. And the biggest destruction that happens is our own knowledge is destroyed, and our own chance to get self-realization is also closed if we allow lust to grow. Therefore, Krishna says that in the very beginning, curb this symbol of sin. How? By regulating the senses. That's what I did with my daughter. I made her use her senses, hear nice Krishna songs, see nice Krishna Vigraha, and enjoy hearing about the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita by removing the pain, personal pain. Means I gave her tailor-made philosophy from Bhagavad Gita just to remove her life's problems, her life's stress, her life's tension. You know, how to stay cool in spite of all the problems using the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. Like this, since I was regularly guiding, you know, then, you know, she got happiness from Bhagavad Gita. Therefore, the lust, you know, could not overtake. So if in the childhood, if we will help them to be Krishna conscious, lust will not trouble. You know, we have to engage their senses in Krishna conscious activities, then lust will not trouble them. So that then they can, when they are getting married, they will be wonderful wives, wonderful mothers, and they will not be suffering due to distraction of love affairs and things like that in their teenage, when they are actually supposed to be focusing on their studies. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.